Welcome to Valley Grove Baptist Church, located at 1731 South, U.S. Highway 281 in Stephenville, Texas. We are glad you joined us for our 10:30 Sunday morning worship service. If you'd like to learn more about Valley Grove, please check us out at our website at valleygrove.net. Now, join us for the morning worship service already in progress.
Power, where is that power?
leading worship this morning. Amen? Amen. Future worship leaders. That's what I hope they will be one day. Let's stand together and sing together the song, Days of Elijah. We will serve together, whether great or small, young or old, we'll serve the Lord together until He calls us home. These are the days of Elijah. Let's sing together the song.
Several more that went home yesterday. We had about four crews that went home yesterday. More coming up. this afternoon and probably even more this week. I think we topped out somewhere in the 80s this week, and probably will push even higher this week of volunteers that are here that are helping, and they're doing some great work around town. Let me just give you a few numbers just to give you an idea. Judge gave me this morning and said today we've had about 233 requests for work turned in. They have fulfilled or closed out 96 requests, so that leaves about 137. Now yesterday they completed 11 and took in 12, okay? So I mean, the process is still going. They're probably going to be here a couple of weeks, so you lift them up in prayer, you pat them on the back, just greet them and visit with them. Been a great blessing. And come Wednesday night, we'll share a fellowship meal together with them, be able to interact there more with them. Great things going on, and we're excited for them to be here and for us to have the opportunity to host and share this with them. It's good to be in God's house. Amen? Hey, let's stand and greet one in the love of Christ. Glad you're here this morning.
A lot bigger than this room. what happens then, they get on an airplane, our boat, and they go overseas. And they go to centers over there. Now, when they get there, people that they're going to, churches, orphanages, villages, somebody in that village or church has been trained about the shoeboxes. But not just the shoeboxes, but about how to tell them about Christ. It's not just the box, but it's letting people know about Christ. So when they get there, they have this kind of like a party, or invite them there, and they give everybody a shoebox, but they also have opportunities to tell them about Christ. Then they tell them, hey, we have a course. If you want to know more about Jesus, we'll teach you in this course. And then they have a graduation from that course, and then more people, they can invite more people, and people will learn about Christ. Y'all just probably thought we did this, right? That we did shoeboxes, and they went over here. Did you know all this stuff happened in the middle? No, that's a lot. So what we're going to do this year is our goal is 175 for the church. That's not, you can do boxes, but so 200 people get 60 cents a week. We could do that. If 90 individuals and families together, we have about 9 months left, getting right at about $7.50 a month, we would meet our goal. So I've been thinking, what should we do when we take boxes off? Because today we're going to take 10 boxes off. So I thought we might be like a baseball game and cheer. Yay! Go 10, get runs. We yell out. Then I thought we might do backflips like a football game. You line up, but you know, work with Tom and hospital bills might come involved if I do backflips every time we move one. So I got to think, you know what I think the best thing to do would be? Is what? I think we should pray for them. That's the very best thing we can do. So today, I'm going to remove 10 boxes.
To the glory of God the Father. Please pray with me. Lord, I just thank you for the example of your son being the perfect example of a humble servant, Lord. I thank you this week as the Baptist men who showed us how we can submit and serve the Lord. If you can serve the Lord with a chainsaw, Lord, and share the love of Jesus as they've shown us, Lord, we all have something that we can serve with and share your love. I just thank you for that example. And I just want us to be mindful that we all have something that we can give, Lord, that shows your love. I thank you for the rain, Lord. I ask that you bring healing to our sick. And please bless our trip next week as we minister to those down on the coast, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Let's continue to stand and to worship the Lord and sing a song your way. As you've been forgiven, we need to take that message out to the world today. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were forgiven. Without worry, amazing.
Lord, we can say that with confidence today,
because we know that you're with us, we know your presence guides us and walks with us in the midst of every struggle, every victory in our life. And Lord, we may be shaken, but we know that our foundation is firm with you with us, and we thank you for that. God, I just pray that you'll speak to the hearts of those who are in this building today. God, may you speak and work in a mighty way. Lord, if there's someone today who needs to know you as Lord and Savior, I pray that today will be the day of salvation for that one. God, if there is someone here who has walked away from you, I pray that today will be the day they walk back into your arms, that is waiting for you to come back, waiting for them to come back to you, Father. God, I just pray that you'd have your will and way, may your spirit move in a mighty way in this place. We love you, Lord. We thank you. In your name we pray.
Bartimaeus was sitting by the roadside begging, his hands were extended in feet. He had little hope of escaping his life, a blind beggar was all he would be. He heard a commotion, people had gathered, someone said Jesus was nigh. He cried, Son of David, have mercy on me. By his faith was given his sight. Make way for the Master, Jesus is passing by. Call out his name, he will bring you life. And here's the blessed hope for all men that brings us from darkness to light. Your faith can make you whole today, for Master is passing by. Yes, the Master is passing by. I had wandered in darkness like a blind man begging, searched for a glimpse of the light. Waking each morning with fear and despair, still haunted by shadows of night. Then one day a preacher talked of a Savior. Someone took me by the hand. I cried out for mercy and he came to me. Jesus is passing.
mirrors right along with what we're going to be talking about as we continue in our spiritual disciplines sermon series. So you be in prayer for him as he comes to share.
I don't think I need a microphone. Can everybody hear me all right? I'm not very good with those things. This week has blessed me more than just unbelievable. Monday morning, there was a crew drove up to my front yard with chainsaws and everything. Got out of their trucks, introduced themselves, we prayed about things, and they went to work. Cutting hanging limbs down, cutting old pine tree down that was shot. I went and got a little boat, know about the boat. Anyway, we drove limbs with it and cleaned up my yard. Daryl Harmon right next door had 16 large live oak trees, literally destroyed. How many limbs lay there were broke out of the pile. And they're still not through with Daryl. They worked on and off with the rain and everything, and they have not quit. And I'm so thankful for them. Tuesday night, sitting in my chair praying, asked God, what can I do? And I thought, well, come sit there a little bit. It came to me, get it up. Be at Battle Road at 7 o'clock in the morning. God will put you to work if you put yourself out for him. I showed up at 7 o'clock, had a good breakfast. Some of the guys that were in said, what are you here for? I said, I want to do whatever I can. They put me with Carol Pratt. Go out and assess damages and all. And I called her my angel all week. She just took me under her arm and we went, I don't know how many we assessed, but we got to pray with people and it was God all the way. I want to give him all credit for everything that happened. We met some of the nicest people, desperate, needing things, drug out of their driveway, everything. Now, I noticed yesterday we was over at the Presbyterian Church Friday morning, assessing damage at the Presbyterian Church. I thought yesterday when it was all cut up coming. I don't know which group it was, but they done a fast job and they done a great job. But anyway, I just want to thank God for what he's done for me this week. And if he knocks on the door, answer.
So let me show you why I believe it's not an overstatement to say that
submission and service are the keys to the fulfillment of the Christian life, or to be at peace with God in our walk with Him. Think for a moment, what would you say is the pinnacle moment of Christ's earthly ministry? Now, for me, I would say it is the moment of the cross. Some might say the moment of His resurrection, and I wouldn't argue that point. I believe, though, that His eyes were always on the cross, and what He accomplished on the cross then made possible what was accomplished in the resurrection. But I think it's the pinnacle moment, and I want to look at that and say, you know, there's that 24 hours before Christ's sacrifice on the cross, what was happening? And I think what you'll see happening is a pattern of submission and service. Submission and service. In those 24 hours, all that Christ came to do, He did in that cycle over and over again. The last 24 hours, they had the Passover meal, the last supper together, He and His disciples. And Christ went to that supper knowing what was ahead of Him, and He was submitting to God's will in that, and even into the last supper with His disciples, and they're submitting to what God has planned for Him, even that He would be betrayed by one of the ones that He had loved and taught. Those years. He submitted himself to God's will, and there God had him served. In this supper that should have been of honoring him, he submitted to God's will and he served, and he got up to wrap a towel around his waist and washed the disciples' feet. There he comes to Peter. Peter says, "The Lord's not washing my feet." And so Jesus got to teach Peter about this cycle. Peter, if you don't submit to me, you have no part with me. Peter, if you don't submit to me, you can't follow me. Peter, if you don't submit to me, then you're not fully one of mine. Peter submitted. He allowed Christ to wash his feet and cleanse him in that beautiful way. And then Jesus taught him the next step. So now go and serve. Now go and do likewise. As you have seen me do, you go and do. The cycle continues. They left the Lord's Supper, that last supper, and they went to the garden, and there Jesus, in beautiful prayers, he prayed for us. He also spent time in agonizing prayer before God, saying, "Lord, please, Father, if there's any other way, let it be. But not my will be done, but thine." And three times that agonizing prayer was prayed, and yet each time he submitted himself to the will of the Father. From that garden, he got up, and his eyes fixed on the cross, went and died in service to you and I and all mankind. All that would receive him, sins forgiven, by the service he accomplished on the cross. See, the pattern is there time and time again of submission and service, submission and service. In fact, if you look through, Jesus' entire earthly ministry was about submission and service. Submission, the Father and I are one. It is not my work that I do, it is the Father's. Serving those in need, serving the will of the Father. Jesus expects the same of us. The pattern that he said is the pattern he expects of his followers. And so today, as we study these keys, these spiritual disciplines that I believe that are the key to peace in the Christian life, turn with me to Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8, and we'll look at some of Jesus' teaching early in his ministry. Mark chapter 8, we're going to pick up in verse 34. Let me give you a little context of where we're at. Jesus has been teaching how things are subject to him and things are under his lordship. And he comes to this portion. Now this piece of teaching comes right after the time of Peter's great declaration and Peter's great correction. Where Jesus had asked, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter, in some of the most beautiful words in the New Testament, say this: "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then just a few moments later, Peter's over there correcting Christ, saying, "No, this is not the way. You're not going to die. We're not going to submit this way." And Jesus has to correct him. "So get behind me, Satan. Your eyes are not fixed on what the Father's will is. You're talking selfishly." So Jesus taught Peter yet again about submission to the Father. So we're going to pick up in verse 34 of Mark chapter 8. Follow along with me. It says, "Then he called to the crowd," that is, Christ called to the crowd, called them to him, along with his disciples, and he said this: "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it if a man is to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his soul? Or what can you give in exchange for your soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. One simple statement lays out the steps that we're talking about this morning. Jesus says, if anyone is to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. The first step is to deny self. What is that? That is submission. In a nutshell, it means Jesus said, if you're going to come after me, you must first submit to me as Lord. To deny self is not self-hate or self-loathing. Really, in a way, it's a love of self because it understands the priority of Christ and the lordship of Christ. But to deny self is about the submission of our own decision to the lordship of Christ. Let me give you a picture of what it looks like. Consider this chair a throne. Today, it represents the throne of your life, of your heart. Now, the throne of your life has but one seat. Only one can sit on the throne of your life at a time. Not room for two, it's not made to be adjusted, it's room for one. But see, the truth is, you get to choose who sits on the throne of your life. God did not demand that he be king and lord of your life. He loves you. He has done everything in the world imaginable to show you that he loves you. He wants desperately to be lord of your life, to sit on that throne, but he won't do it unless you ask him. You and I get to choose who sits on the throne. And we do well to choose wisely. Jesus even taught us to deny self. It may be our throne, but the best decision is not for us to sit upon it. The best decision is that we yield in submission to Christ and let him sit upon it. To choose Jesus to sit on the throne is the submission that Christ calls us to. It is the denying of self, the submission of the throne of our lives to the lordship of Christ instead of the lordship of me. The truth is that submission is this beautiful, I don't want to say double-edged sword, but it's a two-layered topic. At first, submission is very elementary. No one comes to the Lord and Jesus as Savior unless they submit their lives to him. We cannot receive his forgiveness unless we submit our lives willingly to him as Lord and Savior of our lives, if we ask him to sit on our throne. Therefore, submission really is very elementary. Life in Christ does not begin until that submission begins. And at that point, we put our faith in Jesus Christ, ask his forgiveness, and ask him to be Lord of our life, to sit upon our throne. Then he takes us from death unto life. It's a very elementary, basic necessity for our faith walk. But there's also the element that submission then is also the key to maturity. Submission is not a one-time event. It is an event with a beginning that brings us salvation by the justification of Christ's blood washing over us in our sins. But it is also a continual act as we continually submit our lives to Christ as Lord. Paul said it beautifully in Galatians 2:20. He said, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. For I have died. Christ lives in me. Paul understood that the submission to Christ as Lord of our lives is elementary and basic and foundational, but it has a continuing effect for all eternity. Submission is the elementary key to justification and salvation. It is also the key to spiritual maturity. Let me show you this in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. A passage very familiar to you, but let me just point out how this continual submission works in the maturing of our lives. Romans chapter 12. 12, verse 2. Let me read this familiar passage to you. Paul says this. He says, "Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." This being transformed, trans means a cross, so it means to be taken across from one form to another, from the form of self, from the form of self-worship and self-lordship, to the form of Christ as Lord, and Christ's ways being present in our lives, and Jesus being Lord of our lives. So we are to submit ourselves, no longer being conformed to the world, but submit ourselves to the lordship of Christ, and in doing so, we are taking a cross from death to life. We are taking away, or excuse me, taking a cross from selfish living to Christ-like living. And it is a pattern that continues to grow and transform us, to shape us into His likeness, rather than in the likeness of the world. You know, we lost a great brother in the Lord and Billy Graham here recently, so there's been a lot of Billy Graham stories going on. Ran across one this week that I think shows us what it means to continually submit to the Lord and let Him grow us and change us. Friends of Billy's was talking to him and said, "You know, Billy, what is your personal prayer life like? I would like to know. I would like to try to imitate that." Billy said, "God has taught him many things about his prayer life over the years, and he's come to understand that prayer life is to be continual, so God has taught him to continually seek God's will anytime, anywhere." He said, "I pray when I'm in the shower. He said, I pray when I'm at the table. I pray when I'm walking. I pray when I'm reading. I pray when I'm on the airplane." He said, "In fact, right now during our conversation, I've been praying, asking God to give me wisdom, asking God to give me the words and the actions that I can say and do to encourage you." Billy Graham understood what it was to submit to God, because God's wisdom and God's ways are what's needed. God's wisdom and God's ways are what's best. I mean, my goodness gracious, this is Billy Graham. Don't you think that Billy Graham had the experience to know what words of encouragement he could share with another brother? And yet he didn't think that he had that. And so he submitted to the lordship of Christ and asked God for him to say. That humbles me. That breaks me down. That caused me to fall on my knees and say, "Lord, forgive me for being so arrogant, for just speaking out of my mouth rather than asking your words to be present in." But that's what it means to submit. Rather than the story of one's asking Billy Graham to come and speak. But this was later in his life. I mean, he had certainly proven his value and worth as a servant, faithful servant of the Lord. And Billy Graham asked him, he said, "Why do you want me to come? Why do you think I would be able to do anything for you and your community?" And he was honest about it. Why? Because he continually submitted himself to the lordship of Christ, understanding that Billy Graham accomplished nothing, and yet God accomplished amazing through a submissive servant. Church, if we don't submit, we'll not accomplish anything. But if we will submit, we can accomplish everything. Because God will be doing it through us. And God will be doing what He has willed to do. And Jesus said, if you're going to come after me, the first thing you've got to do is submit. Deny yourself. It's not you sitting on the throne that's going to do it. It'll be me as Lord of life. Without submission, we are constantly battling the Holy Spirit, and we'll never be at peace because we're always wrestling with Him. We must constantly submit the throne of our lives to the lordship of Christ. But there's more. That is, without service, we're missing the element of our faith that was the highlight reel of Jesus' ministry. Not to be served, but to serve. There's only one throne. And if you're sitting on it, waiting to be served, then you can't serve. If we're going to serve as Christ served, then we've got to get off the throne, let Him be Lord of it, so then we're free now to go and serve. You know, Jesus didn't come to earth to sit on the throne. He came to serve, didn't He? Does He sit on the throne today? Amen. Yes, He does. Why? Because this service is complete. And now He sits at the right hand. But in His earthly time here, He came not to sit on the throne. He came to serve, submitting to the Father's will. And He asked the same of us.
But if it's us sitting on the throne, then we can't follow through and serve us because we're sitting there ready to be served. Turn with me again to Philippians chapter 2. Those verses that Carrie read earlier, I want to visit again. Because it summarizes in such a beautiful way what it is Christ came to do. Philippians chapter 2, picking up in verse 6, it says this. In verse 5, it says our attitude should be the same as Christ Jesus. Verse 6, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. Christ left glory in submission to the Heavenly Father that he might come and serve. Christ left glory to come and serve unworthy mankind. He did not consider equality with God to be something to be grasped in his human ministry here. But he made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, found in the appearance of a man, humbled himself, became obedient, submissive, even unto death, even death on the cross. I don't know if you noticed, get a chance, take a look, and see what the Texas Baptist Men's motto is. The motto may not be the right word, but if you look at it, it has a cross up there, above the cross it says love. That's not the full story. Under it says, more than words. Love with more than words. And they're here this week in submission and service to Christ as Lord of their lives, serving as Christ has called them to serve in love with more than words. Apostle James said it in a very similar fashion. He says, let me show you my faith by what I do. Let me show you that Jesus Christ is Lord of my life. Let me show you by my submission to Him as Lord and my following through in service for all that He has planned. Ephesians 2:10, turn there if you want to. Christ says, or Paul says that we are Christ's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God has planned in advance for us to do. You know that where you sit here today, God has already got plans for you to do in service to His kingdom and in love for others. See, they're already planned. You don't have to think about them. All you've got to do is listen. He'll tell you what they are. They're already planned. And they're planned for every believer. Because Christ said, you're going to follow after me, you're going to deny self, submit to me as Lord. And then you're going to take up your cross. You know what take up your cross means? It means be busy. Submit and serve. Deny self. Take up your cross. That's what it means to follow Christ. But we can't follow Christ if we don't submit and serve. Mark Batterson, in his latest book, asked a question. Question is this, is God's voice the loudest voice in your life? Is God's voice the loudest voice in your life? He says if it's not, it's a problem. Because it ought to be the loudest voice that we hear. But we're not going to hear God's voice if it's us sitting on the throne. Because if it's us sitting on the throne, then we've already said, you're not Lord of my life. I am. And so we're not going to hear His voice. Because we're not seeking. We're not trying to hear the shepherd. The way we hear God's voice as the loudest voice in our lives is not for us to be sitting there with Him. For us to be kneeling beside it with Him sitting upon it. So that our ear is pointed directly to His mouth. So that in that submission, ready to serve, we hear what the Lord has for us. Is God's the loudest voice in your life? If not, let's leave here with that changed. And if it is, let's leave here listening to what he has planned, because he's going to come.